take you on a soft-spoken journey to the paranormal world of Bigfoot as we investigate through the forests and beautiful countrysides of the Pacific Northwest, walking along a lovely trail and enjoying the scenery as you listen to the sound of my voice. At any point during this recording, you feel the need to close your eyes and create your own story in your dreams. That's perfectly okay. You can always come back another time. So, without further ado, let's dive in. Bigfoot, also known as Sasquatch in the Canadian American folklore, is an ape-like creature that is proportioned to inhabit the forests of North America. Supposed evidence of Bigfoot's existence is based on a number of disputed video recordings, audio recordings, photographs, visual sightings, casts of large footprints, and more. Some of these are speculated. Some are known to be hoaxes. Folklorists trace the figure of Bigfoot to a combination of factors and resources, including folklore surrounding the European wild man figure. Folklore belief among Native Americans and loggers alike aims a cultural increase in environmental concerns. Within the fringe of the subculture of cryptozoology, Bigfoot is considered by some to be a cryptid, but the majority of mainstream scientists have historically discounted the evidence of Bigfoot, considering it to be a combination of folklore, misidentification, and hoax, rather than a living animal. Thousands of people have claimed to have seen the Bigfoot, which is commonly described as a large, muscular, bipedal, ape-like creature, roughly 6 to 9 feet tall, covered in shaggy hair, which could either be the colors black, dark brown, reddish brown, and auburn. A pungent, foul-smelling odor is sometimes associated with the reports of the creature as well. Enormous footprints from which the creature is named are claimed to be large as 610 milliliters or 24 inches long and 200 milliliters or 8 inches wide. Some footprint casts have contained claw marks, making it likely that they came from animals such as you would expect to be bears, which also have 5 toes and claws. Most famously is the Patterson film, an American short motion picture of an unidentified subject, which filmmakers have claimed was actual footage of Bigfoot. The Bigfoot was shot in Northern California in 1967 and has since been subjected to numerous attempts to debunk and authenticate the footage. Alongside Bluff Creek, 25 logging miles or 40 kilometers in Del Norte County, California was the film's location. 38 miles south of Oregon Gates, the exact location of the site was lost, primarily because of regrowth of the foliage in a stream bed after the Great Flood of 1964. It was rediscovered quite recently in 2011. It is just south of the northern running segment of the creek, informally known as the Bowling Alley. Roger Patterson and Robert Baum Gremlin, born in 1931 and 1933, filmed the incredible shot. Patterson, even to his final days, maintained right to the end that the creature in the film was indeed real. As their stories went, it was early afternoon on Friday, October 20th, 1967. Patterson and Gimlin were riding generally northeast, upstreamish, on horseback along the bank of Bluff Creek. At some time between 1:15 and 1:40 p.m., they came to an overtorn tree at the large root system at the turn of the creek, almost as high as an entire room. When they rounded it, there was a log jam left over from the flood of 64, and then they spotted the figure behind it nearly simultaneously. It was either crouching beside the creek to their left or standing there on opposite bank. Gimlin later described himself in a mild state of shock after seeing the figure. Patterson initially estimated its height to be 6 feet 6 inches to 7 feet, and later raised his estimate to about 7 feet 6 inches. Some later analysts and anthropologists, Grover Krantz among them, have suggested Patterson's later estimate was about a foot too tall. Gimlin's estimate was 6 feet. The film shows what Patterson and Gimlin claim was a large, hairy, bipedal ape-like figure with short, silvery brownish or dark reddish brown black hair covering most of its body, including its prominent self and figure. The film generally matches the descriptions of Bigfoot offered by others who claim to have seen him. The figure in the film generally matches the descriptions of Bigfoot offered by others who have claimed to have seen one. Patterson estimated he was about 25 feet away from the creature at his closest. Patterson said that his horse reared up on him, sensing the unusual figure, and he spent about 20 seconds getting himself from the saddle, controlling his horse, and getting to its other side, and getting the camera from within the saddlebag before he could turn toward the figure while operating his camera. Gimlin crossed the creek on horseback after Patterson had run well beyond it, riding on a path somewhat to the left of Patterson's, somewhat beyond his position. Perez estimates that within 60 to 90 feet, the figure had walked away from them from a distance of about 125 feet. Before Patterson began to run after it. The resulting film, which was only about 59.5 seconds long at 16 FPS, is initially quite shaky until Patterson got about 80 feet from the figure. At that point, the figure glanced over its right shoulder at the man. The creature looked back at them with contempt and disgust. You know how it is when the umpire tells you one more word and you're out of the game. That was how it felt. Shortly after this point, the steady middle portion of the film begins, containing the famous look back frame. Patterson said it turned a total of, I think, 3 times. Shortly after glancing over its shoulder on the film, the creature disappeared behind the grove of trees for 14 seconds, then reappeared in the film's final 15 seconds after Patterson moved 10 feet to a better vantage point. Fading into the trees again and being lost to view at a distance of 265 feet as the reel of the film ran out. Gimlin quickly remounted his horse and followed it, keeping his distance until it disappeared around the bend in a road of 300 yards away. Patterson called him back at this point, not sure if there were more of these creatures about. The entire encounter had lasted less than 2 minutes. The next, Gimlin and Patterson rounded up the horses, which had run off in opposite directions, downstream, before the filming again. Patterson got off his second roll of film from his saddlebag and filmed the tracks. Then the men tracked Patty for either 1 mile or 3 miles, but lost it in the heavy undergrowth. They went to their campsite, 3 miles south, picked up a plaster, returned to the initial site, measured the creature's step length, and made 2 plaster casts, one of each of the best quality right and left footprints. More details, according to Patterson and Gimlin. They were the only witnesses to their brief encounter with the one claimed to be Sasquatch. Their statements agree in general, but author Greg Long notes a number of inconsistencies. They'd offered somewhat different sequences in describing how they and the horses reacted upon seeing the creature. Patterson, in particular, increased his estimates of the creature's size in subsequent retellings of the encounter. In different contexts, Long argues, these discrepancies would probably be considered minor, but given the extraordinary claims made by Patterson and Gimlin, any apparent disagreements in perception or memory are definitely worth noting. Film's defenders have responded by saying that commercially motivated hoaxers would have got their story straight beforehand so they wouldn't have disagreed immediately upon being interviewed, and on so many points, so they wouldn't have created a suit in a creature for suitably objectionable features and behaviors. More serious objection concerns of the film's timeline. This is important because the film movie, as far as known, could only have been developed by a lab containing a $60,000 machine, and a few West Coast labs known to possess one did not do developing over the weekend. Patterson's brother-in-law claims not to remember where he took the film for development and where he picked it up. Critics claim that too much happened between filming at 1:15 at the earliest, and the filmmaker's arrival in Willow Creek at 6:30 at the latest. All of the problems with the timeline disappear if the film is shot a few days or hours beforehand. If that is the case, one has to wonder what other details of the story are wrong. The film's defenders retort that although the time window was tight, it was doable. Chris Murphy wrote, "I have confirmed with Bob Gimlin and Patterson definitely rode a small quarter horse, which he owned, not a Welsh pony, Peanuts. Also that Patterson had arranged to borrow a horse by the name of Chico for Bob and Gimlin to use. Gimlin did not have a horse that was suitable for the expedition. He stated that this horse would be calm and work well." So what do you think? Do you think that the footage is real? Have you ever seen it? I know I have, and you probably have too. So let's go more into something that might explain the history and why these men might have seen what they thought they had seen. The earliest of the wild men to appear in literature can be found in the Epic of Gilgamesh. The stories, which are about 4,000 years old, were written on 12 clay tablets and were discovered in a library in the ruins of Nivea. There is no evidence at all that the Epic of Gilgamesh was based on reality, but some do speculate that the stories were written around the actual king of some of the named who lived in the southern Babylonia, modern-day Iraq. According to the history, Aurora the Potter created Wild Man Induku from clay. He was shaggy, with hair that sprouted like rain, who ate with the gazelles and drank with the wild beasts at the water holes. Initially enemies, Enkidu fought alongside Gilgamesh and earned his respect and friendship to such an extent that Enkidu is mortally wounded in battle, and Gilgamesh cries out, "Like a wailing woman, I cry for my friend." The important point here is that Gilgamesh viewed Enkidu, the wild man, as a man, saying, "My friend who endured all hardships with me has been overtaken by the fate of mankind." Going deeper, in 500 BC, the historian Herodotus spoke about hairy monsters in Libya and in Greek and Roman traditions. There are stories of a half-man, half-beast creatures known as satyrs. They are often depicted as having horns and tails, and other types of satyrs were called fauns, nymphs, and according to the professor Boris Bushy, different ways of depicting some surviving dominants. In medieval Europe, according to Amira Shackley, medieval wild men were generally hairy, with both human and animal traits. Often they were covered with hair, except for their face, feet, and hands. But unlike the satyrs of Greek-Roman imaginations, the tail and the horns were absent. However, Shackley makes the interesting point that although the wild man appears in an enormous range of medieval literature, he does not seem to occur in contemporary letters of semi-official documents. So, perhaps the notions of medieval wild men were grounding more in folklore and myth rather than actual fact. The first written account of the Northern American wild man occurred in 986 AD when Leif Erikson and his men landed in the New World, several centuries before Christopher Columbus, I might add. In Samuel Eliot Morrison's account of the Norse voyages, Erikson mentions creatures which were horribly ugly, hairy, swarthy, and with big black eyes. Peter Byrne, in his book, The Search for Bigfoot, Monster, Myth, or Man, however, concedes that it was more probable that these creatures they encountered were simply Native Americans. Byrne argues that the Norse word skilring, which is used to describe these creatures and people, in actual fact, barbarian, which may have well been used to describe the local Native Americans, but he is puzzled by the skulking hairy being. As Illitaks have known, the Norse were a hairy people themselves. Big men with matted hair and beards? Why did they remark that the skulking being hairy? That is weird. However, the legend of Bigfoot exists long before white men arrived in the New World. The coastal Native American tribes of British Columbia, and in particular, the Kahwatuits, had carved totem poles and face masks which clearly reference the man-beast. Indeed, face masks were carved into the image of a ferocious-looking creature known as Buquas and wild men of the woods. In examining the Buquas face masks, Don Hunter, a highly respected Canadian journalist, says that each of the carvings in its stylistic way suggests a creature that is more considerably more human in appearance than it is an animal. The Kahwatuits were not the only Native American tribes to have legends involving hairy wild men. The Hoopa Indians of Northern California tell stories of what they call Oma, the boss of the woods. According to Hoopa legend, he lives out in the mountains and never comes down to the valleys. To be referred to as the boss of the woods, the creature must be pretty domineering. The Chalice tribes of British Columbia referred to Bigfoot as Sasquatch, meaning wild man of the woods, and there were legends of of stickmen of Washington Mountains. Indeed, with minor variations in behavior and appearance, the creature, under its many names, plays a role in Western and Native American lore from northern BC to California, and somewhat lesser, though similar, role in Native culture across the continent. As the tribes of European explorers in New Worlds made contact with Native tribes, their attributes and beliefs were recorded in notes and diaries. It is in these sources of information that we can understand more about the Native American beliefs in Bigfoot. Jose Moreno Murcia, in his book Natica de Nuca, published in Spanish in 1792, wrote, quote unquote, "I do not know what to say about the Matlocks or Sasquatch, inhabitant of the mountains and districts, of whom all have an unbelievable fear. They imagine his body as most monstrous, all covered with stiff black bristle, a head similar to a human, but with much greater, sharper, and stronger fangs than those of a bear, extremely long arms, and toes and fingers armed with long, curved claws. They say, force those, they hear them to the ground, and any important body he slaps is broken to 1,000 pieces. Another early settler, David Thompson, kept a daily journal when he crossed the Rockies near the present site of Jasper, Alberta, in the winter of 1811. He came across what nowadays would perhaps be called Bigfoot footprints. He writes, quote unquote, "Continuing our journey in the afternoon, we came on a track of a large animal. The snow about 6 inches deep on the ice, they measured it, 4 large toes of 4 inches in length to each short claw. The ball of the foot sunk 3 inches lower than the toes. The hinder part of the foot did not mark well. The length, 14 inches by 8 inches in breadth, walking from north to south, and having passed about 6 hours, we were in no humor to follow him. Its size was not that of a bear," end quote. Another explorer, Paul Kane, also appears to have pointed that the Native Americans appeared to be frightened of a race of beings. His entry dates March 27, 1847, reads, "When we arrived at the mouth of the Calipoon River, 26 miles from Vancouver, Washington, I stopped to make a sketch of the volcano, Mount St. Helens, distant, I suppose, about 30 or 40 miles. These mountains have never been visited by either the whites or the Native Americans. The latter assert that it is inhabited by a race of beings of a different species, who eat their own, and who they held in great dread. These superstitions are taken from man. They say they went into the mountains with another and escaped the fate of his companion, who was taken. I offer a considerable bribe to any Native American who would accompany me in its exploration, but could not find one hardy enough to venture there," end quote. In the late 1890s, near the Chetco River in the southern Oregon, a dozen loggers and their families encountered a great beast with disastrous results. Camping in tents by the river, the lumbermen would awaken each morning to find their freshly cut timber, logs which required 3 men to move, carelessly scattered about like matchsticks. Huge human footprints left in the damp earth were the only clues. Since they had been having trouble with bears, the men followed the footprints through the torn shrubbery and uprooted saplings until they disappeared. That night, the loggers were awakened by a shrill of screams of something quite not human in the near underbrush. One man lit a torch and headed into the darkness. He was quickly followed by several other men. In a very short time, the first man rushed back to collapse in terror at the feet of his tracking companions. He babbled incoherently about a hairy monster 8 feet tall with yellow eyes, fangs, and hands like a man. His description put the camp in an uproar. The next night, two men decided to track it. They carried a small lantern and disappeared into the darkness behind the tents. Back in the camp, their friends heard screams and shrieks and the sound of terror. Then, silence. When the two men did not reappear, the other loggers grabbed lanterns and torches and set out to find their fallen friends. A half a mile from camp, they found the scene of a desperate struggle. But the hairy creature that was responsible was not there. It led with footprints, very large, deeper into the woods. The loggers struck camp and left the area next day. Professional hunters entered the forest in the days that followed, but found no sign of the creature. Skeptics, no doubt, will not be satisfied until they have found Bigfoot. However, this was almost the case in 1884, when near the city of Yale, British Columbia, a strange creature was captured that some called a young Bigfoot. Jacko, as it was become known, was something of a gorilla type, standing at 4 feet 7 inches tall and weighing 127 pounds. While being transported, Jacko mysteriously disappeared and was never heard from again. The arrival of the 20th century ushered in a new wave of Bigfoot encounters. According to the Victorian colonist, in 1901, Mark King, one of the best timber cruisers, men who search out good, accessible stands of timber for logging companies in the province, who is known as a five-man with inevitable reputation for reliability, was working alone in Vancouver Island when his Native American packers refused to accompany him, fearing what called the Beast Man. It was late afternoon when King sighted the man beast, who was bending over a pool washing some roots. On seeing or hearing King, it gave a startled cry and ran swiftly up the hillside. King described the creature as covered in reddish brown hair. His arms were particularly long and were used freely in climbing and brush running, while the trail showed a distinct human foot, but with phenomenally long spreading toes. Dramatic event was reported in 1907 when the captain of a steamship, the Capilano, sailing up the BC coast, suddenly found himself being hailed by a canoe loaded with Native Americans, frantic to get away from their small community of Bishop's Cove. They had been scared away by the wild man who appears on the beach at night, who howls in an unearthly fashion between intervals of exertion and clam digging. It seems a rather funny image, that of a frightening beast howling as it digs for clams. Nevertheless, it had scared them so bad that they deserted their village. In 1924, saw two of the most famous Bigfoot encounters. The first involved an astonishing story by Albert Ostman, who claimed he was kidnapped by the Sasquatch and held captive for a week. story would no doubt be ignored as the fanciful whims of a crazy man, but everyone who has met Osmond was impressed by his sincerity and his description of the Sasquatch. In an age when there was no widespread information available, have been confirmed, the second case is far more violent and involves the story of four miners attacked in their log cabin by several rocks-throwing ape creatures. In the area of Washington State called Ape Canyon, once again, their story checks out, and witnesses who saw the men after their ordeal were absolutely certain that they were in such an emotional state that something pretty scary must have happened to them. One must bear in mind that these were tough, rugged, seasoned miners who were in no disposition to show any emotions or weaknesses. Particularly that would be fear. So Quentin dedicates, saw many encounters and newspaper reports of sightings and footprints. But as per usual, they were regarded by most people as pranks and hoaxes over the eager imagination. May 1950 saw the disappearance of an experienced mountaineer and expert skier, Jim Carter, in Ape Canyon. He was part of a 20-strong climbing party from Seattle. Search parties combed through the area for weeks, but found nothing. His tracks in the snow showed that he was running at great speed, as if to evade capture, and had even jumped over great crevices. Several members of the party did comment that they felt that they were being watched by something or somebody, and could feel the hair on the back of their necks stand up. As to that what happened to him, two members of the climbing party, Bob Lee, as a well-known mountaineer in the 1961 Himalayan expedition, and leader Dr. Otto, the surgeon for the Seattle Mountain Rescue Council, concluded that the apes got him. Another significant sighting in the annals of the Bigfoot lore occurred in 1955, when William Rowe sighted a female Bigfoot near the town of Titijuan-Caché, British Columbia. This case is significant because the level of detail that witness is able to remember about the creature. William Rowe was so confident in the truthfulness of his story that he even signed a sworn affidavit in front of the commissioner for oaths. Jerry Crew and a newspaper story that introduced the world to Bigfoot. However, it wasn't until the remote Bluff Creek area of Northern California was opened up for logging that Bigfoot really entered the mainstream culture. The loggers would turn up on the site each morning and discover that the equipment had been disturbed, and indeed a 50-gallon fuel drums tossed around as if empty. About 20 miles of that road had been built when the big tracks started to appear. They were made at night in intervals of about a week. Their basic routine was to cross the road to get from the hillside to the creek bed, but sometimes they went for a short distance along the road and even circled the park machines. The tracks were all made by the same individual, were roughly 16 inches long and 18 inches wide. These footprints impressed almost an inch into the ground, whereas the logger's boots barely made an impression on the surface. Logging foreman Jerry Crew said, quote unquote, "I've seen hundreds of these footprints in the past few weeks. Every morning, we find footprints in the fresh earth we've moved the day before," end quote. Jerry Crew made a plaster cast of one of these footprints and took it to the local newspaper. The newspaper editor commented that had a Bigfoot and ran the story with the word Bigfoot used for the very first time. Resulting news stories was picked up and Associated Press Wire and Bigfoot, as titled, became famous. The mystery took another twist 9 years later in Bluff Creek. Roger Patterson and Bob Gimlin captured what they claimed was a female Bigfoot. The film, known as Patterson film, is without exception and the most controversial piece of Bigfoot evidence ever recorded. Entire books have been written about it for many hours spent analyzing the 952 frames of color film, and yet, even to this day, no one has managed to prove that the film is real or a hoax. As this was a very significant piece of evidence, I have devoted more time to it here. The Patterson film is, in effect, the dividing line between historical Sasquatch and the modern era Bigfoot. The mystery would never be the same again. Bigfoot in the 1970s was hijacked by the media and soon became a modern television and TV star. He even fought the $6 million man and was used in countless TV commercials. Unfortunately, this brought with it the usual crankpots, and their stories and tabloid press further reinforced the belief among most people that the Bigfoot mystery was just some silly hoax. With typical headlines being more ludicrous by the second, and with fame came the hoaxers who no doubt muddled the waters as far as serious researchers were concerned. This then was how Bigfoot phenomenon remained in most people's minds, an implausible hopscotch myth, silly stories, and ultimately hoaxes. The mystery did not deserve to be taken seriously. Serious researchers, however, knew the phenomenon was having a deep history, sketching back as far as the arrival of the white man in North America, and indeed rooted not only in myth and legend, but possibly even in reality. Alleged behaviors. The alleged eyewitnesses and individuals researching the phenomenon of Bigfoot have indicated a number of disputed behaviors supposedly related to the creature. Some of these reported up behaviors include patterned, repetitive knocking sounds, pine cones being thrown, objects like rocks and logs commonly called wood knocking, rock howling, vocalizations such as howls, moans, grunts, whistles, and even some form of supposed language. Most other stories also account for strange, high-pitched whistling, sometimes mistaken for that of a bird, but cannot be placed for the region that it was heard. Some of these alleged vocalization recordings have been analyzed by individuals such as retired U.S. Navy cryptozoologist and linguist Scott Nelson. Nelson analyzed audio recordings from the early 1970s and said to be recorded in the Sierra Nevada mountains dubbed the Sierra Sounds, and stated, "It is definitely a language. Is definitely not human in origin, and it could not have been faked." Additionally, structures consisted of broken twists of tree limbs placed seemingly in specific areas have been discovered in the forest and have been attributed to the Bigfoot. Many alleged sightings are reported to occur at night, leading to some speculations that the creature may possess nocturnal tendencies. However, mainstream science largely disputes this claim, as all known apes, including humans, are diurnal, with only lesser primates possessing nocturnality. Numerous plaster casts of alleged Bigfoot footprints exist, and some of these casts have been studied by individuals and experts alike. Through their experiences and tests, they believe that some of these casts contain unique dermal ridges and even evidence of healed scars. A body print was taken in the year 2000 near the Clifford National Forest in Washington State and is believed by some have made a Sasquatch that sat down in the mud to eat fruit left out by researchers during the filming of an episode of Animal X. Skeptics believe the cast to have been made by an animal such as an elk. Claims about the origin and characteristics of Bigfoot have also also crossed over with other paranormal claims, including that Bigfoot, extraterrestrials, and UFOs are related, or that Bigfoot creatures are psychic, can cross into different dimensions, and are completely supernatural in origin. Other claims have been made linking the creature to a religious origin and other such things. What do you think? Do you think that the Bigfoot is real? Or is it an elaborate hoax? What about all the sightings from so long ago and the footage? Or maybe even the very large casts of giant feet. Let me know what you think in the comments below. Thank you for joining me for this whispered, soft-spoken, and interesting episode of Cats and Crafts and Relax. And as always, stay safe, happy, and healthy. I'll catch you next time.